This is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Good morning, everybody. I'm Chandy. I am so excited to share this morning's devotion and continual feast in the Word of God and in the hope that we have in Him. Hope you're encouraged today. My focus this morning is from Psalm 118, where this verse comes from. This is the day the Lord has made, and we will rejoice. It's a very familiar passage we teach to our children, and this whole chapter of Psalm 118 is full of verses that we have quoted so many times, and famous preachers have quoted them. Jesus himself quotes several verses from this chapter. And this is the day the Lord has made, comes towards the end of this chapter, and we'll get to it. But the beginning of Psalm 118 begins this way. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for He is good. You know, many psalms begin with praise the Lord, or behold, bless the Lord, or give thanks to the Lord. But this has a little bit of a difference in its tone. It begins with an exclamation. It begins with emotion. It begins with this word, oh, give thanks. It's a plead. It's an emphatic call for us, to us, to give thanks to the Lord. And the reason to give thanks to the Lord is simply and profoundly this. Give thanks to the Lord, for He is good. All of our life can be summed up in our relationship with God, can be summed up in this introduction. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for He is good. And this verse stands alone, and it declares who God is, His nature, His inherent being, his who He is to us. All by itself. It does not refer to our circumstances. It doesn't get into the writer. It doesn't get into the circumstance of his life and then say, because of all those things, God is good. No, it stands alone. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for He is good. And we're encouraged in the New Testament to continue in everything, give thanks. Not for everything, but in everything. That means in every circumstance, give thanks, not with the focus on the circumstance, but with the focus on that God is inherently good in who He is. In His nature, He is good. And it begins to develop right after that. But there's a famous preacher, Charles Spurgeon. He took on this verse, and here's what he says. He says, those who only praise God because He does them good should rise to a higher note and give thanks to Him because He is good. I feel this is a secret for those who want to live a life of radical obedience and radical faith and radical walk with God. There's a huge difference in knowing God because of what God has done for us, and that's not wrong at all, but it's another level, a higher level of our relationship with Him, knowing God for who He is and praising and giving Him thanks purely and wholly for who He is. I'll read that quote again. Those who only praise God because He does them good should rise to a higher note and give thanks to Him because He is good. Charles Spurgeon was one of the famous preachers of his time, and he used to, his church was a 10,000 member church, and people would gather from all over to hear that kind of exhortation. He's known as one of the greatest devotional writers in history. And this really marks this whole chapter, knowing the nature of God and then introducing our circumstance, our life, situations that we're facing into that context. And right after that, there's a call. Now let Israel say, His mercy endures forever. Now let Aaron say, His mercy endures forever. And let those who fear the Lord say, His mercy endures forever. See, here is now the application. He's calling people in every facet, from a nation to the priesthood, and to all the people who fear the Lord, declare that His mercy endures forever. Now, what's the context of this chapter? What's the context in which he's writing these verses? Here's the context. All the nations surrounded me. Yes, they surrounded me, but in the name of the Lord, I will destroy them. I know it sounds pretty harsh. They surrounded me like bees, and they were quenched like a fire of thorns. For in the name of the Lord, I will destroy them. You punish me violently that I may fall, but the Lord helped me. See, this is a context in which the psalmist is coming to write this chapter. He's pressed in on all sides. It says all the nations have surrounded him, but he begins with this declaration, "Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good." And I hope you can apply this in your life, no matter what the circumstance, no matter what's surrounding you in the present, from the past, or into your thoughts concerning your future. We have this opportunity to declare that God is good. And it goes on to, and there are many other famous verses, "Open to me the gates of righteousness, I will go through them." And verse 21, "I will praise you, for you have answered me and have become my salvation." 22 and 23, 22 is one that Jesus quotes, "The stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone." And on and on and on it goes. And towards the end, also there's another verse, "The Lord is my strength and my song, and he has become my salvation." You see, the language is that he has become, out of the knowledge that he is our salvation. He is good. His mercy does endure forever. And in this context is this verse that says, "This is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it." What is the day? The day that the nations surrounded him. What is the day when they were pushing him so that he would fall? What is the day when he felt that he would die? And it's in this context he says, "I shall live and not die." You see, the circumstances were against him, but he is able to, at this point, declare, the writer is able to declare, "This is the day the Lord has made, and I will rejoice, and I will be glad in it." So the circumstances is not encouraging us to rejoice. The circumstances is not encouraging us to be glad. I don't even know if the writer is glad in that moment, but he's saying, he's declaring, "This is a day," and in this declaration, "I will rejoice and I will be glad." It's almost speaking to his own soul and his own spirit. Come on, rejoice in the Lord. Come on, be glad in him. Find that vein, find that place, find that secret place of rejoicing in God, so that we can align our hearts, our lives, our families, everything that God has given us, to the place where we give thanks to him purely for his goodness. And then we allow God to perform miracles on our behalf into all of those circumstances. So I want to leave this chapter with you. Read it when you have time and allow God to speak to you. Allow him to stand alone in your life above and beyond all of our circumstances, so we can declare he is good, and we can declare that this day and every day in God is made by him and is made for us to rejoice and be glad in him. God bless you. Have a fantastic day.